Hi everyone, we are so glad that you are joining with us this morning for worship. We are Shore Street Presbyterian Church in Donaghadee, and even though we are meeting separately, we are so aware that we are part of something bigger. We are part of the worldwide Church of God, and we remain to be part of that smaller unit in Donaghadee as Shore Street, and that's really important to us. So whether you are worshipping this morning on your own, or if you have a house filled with people, filled with chaos, please know that we are praying for you. We are praying that you will encounter God this morning. We are praying that you will hear his voice speaking to you. And we're praying that the Holy Spirit will help you as you worship him this morning. This morning, we're excited that Alvin is continuing his series on Habakkuk. And with those questions, why, God, why? And I know many people have those questions. We don't understand why things happen in the way they do, what's going on. So as we look at the Word of God today, we're just really praying that we will get a sense of who God is in all of this and who we are in light of who he is. So we're excited to continue on in Habakkuk. But as you come to worship this morning, I'd love you to take a moment, and I would love you to close your eyes, no matter what's going on in your home or round about you, but to close your eyes and focus on the one that you have come here to worship. That one true and living God. The one who's worthy of all of your worship. The one who loves you. The one who cares for you. The one who is always with you. I want you to take this moment to choose to look to God and to consider his worthiness, his worth. Psalm 16 says, "Keep me safe, O God, for in you I take refuge." I said to the Lord, "You are my Lord. Apart from you, I have no good thing." Father God, apart from you, we have no good thing. You are our refuge. You are our safe place. Father God, we have come to worship you this morning. We have come to declare your worth and your glory, your majesty, your might, and your power. We're so thankful that we are your people, that you are our God, that you have chosen us, that you love us. We're thankful for your faithfulness, your patience. We're thankful that we can trust you and give our lives to you. Lord, we choose to give ourselves to you afresh again today. And Father, we ask for your forgiveness. We ask you for forgiveness for times when we have sought other things and other people to fulfill us, to sustain us, to support us. When at times we haven't sought you as our one true good thing. Father, forgive us for our sins, of the things that we have said, the things that we have left unsaid, the things that we have done, the things that we have left undone. Father, we pray for your forgiveness. We are so thankful that you do forgive us, that through Jesus' death, through his resurrection, that not only we have forgiveness of our sins, but we also have hope. Hope for today, but also hope for eternity. Thank you, Father. And we pray once more that you would refill us, refuel us with your Holy Spirit, where we would hear your voice speaking to us, where we would know your direction and your leading. Holy Spirit, we ask that you would help us in our worship today. Help us to give ourselves completely to you, God. Lord God, you know what we have come with this morning. You know the things that have already gone on in our homes and our hearts today. You know, the anxieties and the worries that we carry. You know, where there is illness, sickness, need. And Father, as we come to worship today, we choose to say that you are God, you are sovereign over all, you are in control of everything, and we give you all of these things, the things that we have no control over, the things that cause us worries and stresses, the things that weigh in our mind, we give them to you and we trust you. You are God and we are not. We love you and we need you. Let's pray together. Let's pray the Lord's Prayer. The prayer that Jesus taught his followers to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Following this, Phil is going to lead us in birthday blessings. Aisling is going to have a talk for the boys and girls, and Gillian and Isla will lead us in a children's song. But before all of that, let's join together in praise and worship. You can sing out loud or just sing in your heart, but let's worship God together.
Majesty. I don't deserve. Hello everybody, I hope you're all well and keeping safe. I just wanted to wish anybody who's had a birthday in the last week or so a big happy birthday. To all the kids who've had a birthday recently, we will send you out something from our kids table from the church. And to all the adults, we will send you out a chocolate bar. So let me pray for those who've had a birthday. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for birthdays, Lord, and we give you thanks for our congregation. Help those who've had a birthday recently, God, to know that we are celebrating with them, Lord, even though we can't be with them personally. And Lord, I pray you'll just bless and protect our congregation at this time, and we look forward to rejoicing with each other when we return. We pray all these things in your name. Amen. Thank you, everyone, and keep safe.
So how many times have you complained this week or even today? Has anyone said, I don't want to do my work, or I don't want to be inside again. I want to go outside and play with all my friends, or I don't want to eat that. Ugh. Or I don't want to get up early. Has anyone said that at all? But to complain, it means that you think that something is so unfair, and we might think that it's not fair for us to stay at home. We might ask lots and lots of questions these days. Have you ever asked a question that people at home can't even answer? There's even questions that Google can't even answer. And in the book of Habakkuk, he does a lot of complaining. He is not happy. But he tells God why. He tells him exactly why he's not happy. Did you know that Habakkuk's name means to wrestle or to embrace? And that's really helpful for us because Habakkuk, he is wrestling with God. Not like the type of arm wrestle that you might be doing at home, but actually he's wrestling with God about why he's not happy. He is doing some complaining. But even though he is complaining to God, he also praises him. And we can read about it. As it says in verse 12, he says, Lord, you are everlasting. And then he goes on and he says that, Lord, you are my rock. God is so big that he can take your complaining. He can take your complaining, your questions, your concerns, all your worries. He can take it all. And in the Bible, we can read about lots of people who trust God. And we know people today who also trust God. And we can trust that God, he pays attention to us. He knows us and he loves us. And he wants you to talk to him. And he loves it whenever you do. And we read in Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5. It says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and don't rely on your own understanding. God knows exactly what you need, even though sometimes we think that we know better. Habakkuk even says to God, how much longer do we have to do this? We seem to be doing a lot of waiting right now. And so did Habakkuk. But maybe God wants us to learn a few things whilst we're in our time of waiting. So during our time of waiting, of learning new things and being creative, do we trust God? So I have a challenge for you. I want you to get some paper, but don't run yet. Just wait, listen to what I am instructing you to do. So you're going to get some paper and some pens or pencils, crayons, whatever you want. And I want you to write on the top of it, I trust God with. And what you have to do is write as many things as you possibly can of what you trust God with. You can draw pictures on this as well. And then I want you to hang it up somewhere in your house that you can see and look at it. And it'll help you to remind you of what we can trust God with. It can be really, really big things, or it can be small things. And big people, you can do this too. This isn't just for children. You can do it as well. And so let's put on our eyes of faith. It tells us in the Bible that we walk by faith and not by sight. And so at the minute, we might be a bit challenged. It might feel like our walls are closing in on us in our house. But let's put on our eyes of faith. Let's look forward, remembering what God can do and remembering what God has already done. Let's be excited about what God is teaching us. Ask yourself, what is God teaching you right now? Children, young people and adults, we can all ask that question. So let's see what God is teaching us. And let's look and remember what we trust him with. Do we trust him with our whole lives or just a part of our lives? Let's look with eyes of faith of what God has already done and what he is going to do. So let me pray for us all. God, I thank you that we can trust you. God, I thank you that you are so big, you are so strong and so mighty. And so, Father, I pray for every child, every young person and every adult that you would draw close to them, that they would trust you, and that we would move forward with our eyes of faith. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You will never run away, you're forever mine. You will never run away, you're by my side.
People who work together to bring this service to us every week. Thankful for that team. A couple of announcements for us. One, just to remind you of that telephone number for those who do not have the internet so that they can listen to the church service. And that little reminder, depending on your own telephone service provider, that can be at the local rate or it can be very expensive, so please remind folks to check that out or get someone to check that out for them.
The other thing we're nervous about, excited about, is this Wednesday coming the 13th of May, we're starting our first online alpha course. So we're actually doing two courses, hopefully, one aimed at 20 to 35 year olds, and then second course aimed at 35 and upwards. Those ages are very, very rough guidelines. Love you to make us known to your friends in Donaghy. Love you to invite folks to come on, so they can do that from the safety of their own couch or living room. I suppose it's aimed particularly for people who maybe haven't been around church, or maybe for one reason or another don't feel comfortable in church. So love you to invite family and friends, point them to the Facebook page, and Dean has details up for us there. Let's pick up the Bible, if you have them with you. This is the second week in our new series, as we explore this small Bible book called Habakkuk, really difficult to find. So I'd love you, just as we read it and as we kind of explore it, that you'd really invite Jesus to come right in into the room that you're sitting in and speak to you so lovingly and touch you so powerfully this morning. So this is Habakkuk chapter 1, but we'll just read the whole chapter. Last week we looked at verses 1 to 4. This week we're going on from verse 5. This is God's word. We love God's word. God speaks to us as we open our hearts and our minds and as we commit to obeying. So here's God's word. The oracle that Habakkuk the prophet received. How long, Lord, must I call for help, but you do not listen? Or cry out to you, violence, but you do not save? Why do you make me look at injustice? Why do you tolerate wrongdoing? Destruction and violence are before me. There is strife and conflict abounds. Therefore, the law is paralyzed and justice never prevails. The wicked hem in the righteous so that justice is perverted. And then the Lord answers. Look at the nations and watch. Be utterly amazed, for I am going to do something in your days that you would not believe, even if you were told. I am raising up the Babylonians, that ruthless and impetuous people who sweep across the whole earth to seize dwellings not their own. They are a feared and dreaded people. They are a law unto themselves and promote their own honor. Their horses are swifter than leopards, fiercer than wolves at dusk. Their cavalry gallops headlong. Their horsemen come from afar. They fly like an eagle swooping to the far. They all come to intent on violence. Their hordes advance like the desert wind and gather prisoners like sand. They mock kings and scoff at rulers. They laugh at all fortified cities. By building earthen ramps, they capture them. Then they sweep past them like the wind and go on, guilty people whose own strength is their God. And that creates a response from Habakkuk, his second complaint. Lord, are you not from everlasting? My God, my Holy One, we will not die. You, Lord, have appointed them to execute in judgment. You, my rock, have ordained them to punish. Your eyes are too pure to look on evil. You cannot tolerate wrongdoing. Why then do you tolerate the treacherous? Why are you silent while the wicked swallow up those more righteous than themselves? You have made people like fish in the sea, like the sea creatures that have no ruler. The wicked foe pulls all of them up with hooks. He catches them in his net. He gathers them up in his dragnet. And so he rejoices and is glad. Therefore he sacrifices to his net and burns incense to his dragnet. For by his neck he lives in luxury and enjoys the choicest foods. Is he to keep on emptying his nets, destroying nations without mercy? Amen. Well, those are some words. Do you remember last week we saw how Habakkuk looked over his city Jerusalem and his nation? And do you remember in verses 1 to 4 how his heart was filled with incredible sorrow and pain and sadness? He was literally heartbroken because of how his friends and his people were living their lives. I mean, they were supposed to be the people of God, but in reality they were far, far from God in their everyday lives. And so verses 1 to 4 gave us those pictures of a society where there's so much arguing and fighting and hitting and hurting, all kinds of wrongs, all kinds of injustices and violence. Violence is a big word in the book of Habakkuk. It appears 6 times in the book. They violated one another, causing unspeakable hurt and pain in their society. And you know, folks, you and I think about our nation and our day. Like, we still have the name of being a Christian country, but the reality is long since gone. We see a society that has increasingly jettisoned God and rejected God's word and God's ways as the bedrock of its laws, of its life, of its everyday choices and behaviour. We see a society that more and more loudly seems to call God's word, the Bible, and God's ways irrelevant, old-fashioned, even regressive and restrictive of our personal freedoms and choices. And just like Habakkuk, it breaks our heart as we look out across our friends here in Northern Ireland and our society throughout Europe and just see how far we've turned our back on God in recent years, morally, spiritually, ethically, sexually, financially. It's like having a devastating effect on our society. And everywhere we look, we see broken relationships, brokenness in our relationship with God, brokenness in our relationship with others as well. And last week we saw that Habakkuk was wrestling with God, saying, God, why don't you do something? Why aren't you doing something, Lord, to turn people's hearts back to you? Why aren't you answering the cries of our hearts and the prayers that we pray? Lord, don't just sit there, do something. So this week we're going to look at how God answers Habakkuk's prayer. And we're going to discover that far from easing Habakkuk's fears, that God's answer only compounds his confusion, his bewilderment, and his amazement, and leaves him with a whole new set of questions to wrestle with that are even bigger than his first questions. So let's jump into it. Here's what struck me when I read these verses. First of all, verse 5, we see God and gives to Habakkuk 3 commands. Habakkuk's been asking God about his own city, his own nation of Judah. But God tells him to look at the bigger picture. In verse 5, look. It's a reference back to verse 3. Look at the nations, plural. Watch out across the world. Be amazed. Be utterly and totally amazed, shocked, stunned, shaken for what I am going to do throughout the world. You know, this whole coronavirus pandemic has stunned and humbled the whole world. I mean, not just one nation. No one has a solution. No one knows how or when this world crisis will end. No one feels safe, no matter what precautions we take as a country or as individuals. We really are living in unprecedented times. But we believe that God is working out his own sovereign and eternal purposes for his glory and also for our good, in ways that we can't even begin to conceive or see or imagine or grasp. Look at verse 5. For I am going to do something in your days that you would not believe even if you were told. And we said, you're right there, God. Like, if you told any of us 6 months ago, 6 years ago, that the whole world would be in lockdown with a virus called coronavirus from China, we wouldn't have believed you, God. We would have thought you were nuts. If only, you know, if only we could see things from God's perspective, from heaven's perspective. You know, if you've ever flown into Belfast Harbour Airport, how things up there in the plane look so totally different from things down here on ground level. And so Samson and Goliath, those two cranes and Harlan Wolf, they look so small from way up there, and yet they look so big to us down here. From a human perspective, this pandemic looks to us as the most unspeakable tragedy and worst nightmare that we have faced in our world. And especially if you have someone who is battling an ICU ward, or worse still, you've lost a loved one in this battle. Or if you've lost a job, or lost a business that you've poured your whole lifetime into, and to see it swept away from you just in a few short weeks. Maybe you've lost sleep, maybe you've lost hope, maybe you've lost certainty. Whatever it is you've lost in this crisis, we know that people are going through unimaginable stress and heartache due to this pandemic. But what if we could maybe see what God is doing in this, over this, through this, above this worldwide catastrophe? We too might be utterly amazed, totally humbled, reduced to awe and wonder and worship. You see, Habakkuk had complained in verses 1 to 4 that God was doing nothing to stop the pain and the heartache and the hurt in his city and nation. And now God says in verse 6, you're wrong, Habakkuk. I am doing something. This is what I am doing. Verse 6, I am raising up the Babylonians. Who are the Babylonians? Well, there are people who come from roughly the area that we call Iraq today. And God gives us, verses 6 to 11, this description of them. I mean, it's hair-raising, to say the least. I mean, I read this, I think ISIS in our generation. ISIS-type ruthless, heartless, merciless people. A brutal war machine that just devours and destroys and steamrollers over the top of everyone and everything that gets in its way. A nation that cares for no one or nothing, only themselves and their own power and success. That's what verses 6 to 11 describe for us. And so no wonder Habakkuk, like us, recoils in horror at God's answer. If his first complaint was about the behaviour of his friends and the people of his own nation, his second complaint to God is about the behaviour of his enemies, this ruthless, brutal nation that's about to completely devastate and decimate Judah and Jerusalem. And basically in verses 12 to 7, Habakkuk is saying to God, God, you know, how can you do this? How can you allow this? How can you permit this, Lord? Like, this is not fair. This is not right. This is not just. Well, we feel that too, don't we, when we look out at what's happening. And Habakkuk struggling, verse 12, Lord, how could you use them to discipline and punish us? They're miles worse than us. How could you do that, Lord? Why would you do that, Lord? It's not right. It's not fair. So we're back to those questions. Why, Lord? Why? How, Lord? How? It goes against everything I know of you, Lord. I'm more confused, bewildered, bothered than ever, Lord. And you can feel that tension in Habakkuk in verses 12 and 13 especially, as he wrestles and struggles and battles to reconcile what he sees and hears from God and what he believes in his heart about God. I don't know if you've ever gone through something so painful, so dark, so difficult, so heartbreaking, so confusing in your life that it challenges everything that you thought you knew and believed and held on to about God. Well, here's a couple of questions for you. What is God really like? What things do I really know and believe about God that won't change, that don't change, even when the storms of life hit and threaten to completely shipwreck my faith and my life? And in verses 12 and 13, you get a sense of what Habakkuk believes about God, even though he's totally bewildered by what he's seeing in front of him in life. And there are some truths here about God that Habakkuk is trying to recite and hold on to in the storms of his life. Look at them. They're simple words. Verse 12, the first word is Lord. Oh, Lord. In your Bible, do you notice that the word Lord is all capitals, L-O-R-D? That's unusual. It comes from a Hebrew word that can be translated Yahweh, Jehovah. And of course, that was a special name that God gave to his people to call him when he called them into that special relationship with himself. It's a name that speaks of God's relentless love for and his unshakable, unbreakable commitment to his covenant people. And so he says to his people through Moses something like this, for you are a people holy to the Lord your God, set apart, special. The Lord your God has chosen you out of all the peoples on the face of his earth to be his people, his treasured possession, the most special thing in his life. The Lord did not set his affection on you and choose you because you were more numerous than other people, for you were actually the fewest. But it was because the Lord loved you. Know therefore that the Lord your God is God, and he is a faithful God. He keeps his covenant of love to a thousand generations of those who love him and keep his commands. Deuteronomy 7, verses 6 to 9. That's what Habakkuk believes in the core of his being. He believes that God has chosen his people. He set his love and affection on them. He is totally committed to them. He is faithful. He will not fail them, not even in the darkest trials of their lives. And folks, if that is true for Israel in the Old Testament, how much more is that true for us now? As we know that we are God's precious sons and daughters, adopted, brought into his very own family through saving faith in Jesus. That we are precious daughters, much loved sons. I mean, do you believe that right now, even though it may not feel like that right now? The second truth that Habakkuk recites is this: everlasting God. Verse 12, God, you are an everlasting God. That's what I believe about you. You know, look at us. We are only human. We are bits of dust and ash. That's all we are. I call us gold dust. We say it in a funeral committal at the graveside, dust you are and to dust you will return. And if there's one thing that this verse has reminded us, it's this. Folks, we are mortal. We are limited. We are vulnerable. We die. We are so small, so tiny, so insignificant. We are tiny specks of dust in a tiny little planet in the tiny corner of the universe. And in sheer contrast to us, God is mega huge. God is everlasting, from everlasting to everlasting, no beginning, no end. You know, I have a prayer that I pray regularly. It goes something like this. You've probably heard it. God, you are God and I am not. You are good and I am not. You are everything that I am not, but you are everything that I would love to be. You're so kind, so good, so pure, so loving, so faithful, so true. And you see that in Jesus, who is the image of his Father, the spitting image of his Father. And so death can't hold him. Death is powerless before him. And God breaks Jesus out from the grave into life and aliveness forever and ever in eternity. And he invites you and me into this very life with Jesus forever and ever in eternity. In Jesus, united to Jesus, we shall not die. Death is never the end of us as believers. Death is never the end of us as lovers and followers of Jesus. No matter what powers there are on earth or in hell, they cannot defeat our God. No matter how powerful coronavirus is, our God is everlasting. That's the second truth that Habakkuk recites. Third truth, verse 12, my God, my Holy One. You see, for Habakkuk, God is not just any old God. Even though he's wrestling and trying to comprehend what's going on, this God is the one that he knows, the one he loves, the one he trusts. He is my God, my Holy One. Like, I know you, Lord, you're my God. A bit like Thomas in the New Testament, after the crucifixion of Jesus and the resurrection, he's bewildered, he's confused, he's perplexed, he's heartbroken by the death and crucifixion of Jesus at the hands of wicked men. And he can't get his head around it. He can't come to terms with the fact that Jesus is now dead. And not only that, then, you know, he cannot bring himself to believe that Jesus is no longer dead, that actually the rest of the disciples are saying to him that Jesus is physically, factually alive, that they have touched him, they have seen him. And he wants proof. He wants concrete, unmistakable, undeniable proof. And he says he cannot believe, he will not believe that Jesus is risen from the dead until he has such proof. And then Jesus miraculously, marvelously enters the room where he is, addresses him personally, invites him to step forward and touch his hands and his feet and to stop doubting and start trusting. And in response, and Thomas cries out these words that are so like Habakkuk's, my Lord and my God. Can I ask you, I mean, is that the kind of close relationship that you have with Jesus? Is your relationship with Jesus that personal, that beautiful, that powerful? Sure, like there are many things that we don't understand in our world right now, many things that you and I are struggling to get our heads around, but this one thing we can know with absolute conviction and joy: Jesus, you are alive today, risen and alive in Donaghadee, and Jesus, you are my God, my Savior, my friend, my hope, my strength, my all. That's our declaration, isn't it? Fourth final truth that Habakkuk recites to himself in verse 12, my rock. Think a rock of Gibraltar that stands out of the sea, or Mount Everest, that rock, that mountain rock that stands above the earth, towering. A rock stands for strength, stability, something unshakable, unmovable, solid. A rock is something that you cling to in a raging sea when everything is being shaken and swept away in the storm. And if coronavirus has taught us one thing, it's reminded us that nothing is certain in our world any longer. It never was. Everything that we relied on, clung to give us success and happiness and peace and joy and meaning and purpose for our lives, has been swept away from under our feet. And yet there's one solid rock in this frightening sea of change. One rock solid person who does not change when everything around us is changing and decaying. And so Psalm 46, many of you will know this so well. God is our refuge and our strength and ever-present help in times of trouble. Therefore, because we believe that's who he is, we will not fear, even though the earth gives way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, even though everything around us crumbles down. Are those fantastic words of Moses when he declares Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 3 and 4, I will proclaim the name of the Lord, the character of God, what he's like. Oh, praise the greatness of our God. He is the rock. His works are perfect. All his ways are just. A faithful God who does no wrong. Upright and just is he. Brilliant. Folks, just like Habakkuk, there's so much going on in our world, our generation, that leaves us bewildered. And at times, truthfully, like Habakkuk, we do wrestle and struggle and battle to line up what we see happening in front of us with what we believe inside us. And in times like these, we need to come back to these core truths that we do know, we do understand, we do believe about who God is and how precious you and I are to him through saving faith in Jesus, sons and daughters, loved. And this is our God. He is the Lord, the one who loves us relentlessly, the everlasting one, way, way beyond us, far, far above us. My God, the one that we know and love in a personal, saving relationship in Jesus our Lord. The rock solid fixture in our lives, who does not change and who will not fail us. Even in the worst tempests and storms that threaten to shatter and destroy our hearts, our homes, our families, our worlds. What do we say in response to this? Well, let me finish with these words from Romans 8. This is what we say. If God is for us, who can be against us? If this God, if our God, if Habakkuk's God, if the God of our Lord Jesus is for us, then who can be against us? We can face coronavirus. We can face whatever our deepest fears. For this God did not spare his one and only Son, but gave him up for us all. How will he not also, along with Jesus, graciously give us all things, everything that we need to face whatever you are facing in your life right now? Who shall separate us from the love of God? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword or coronavirus? No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors, overcomers through him who loved us. What a powerful, powerful picture and reminder of who God is. Does it not reduce you to awe and wonder and worship? Because folks, that's what it's meant to do. That's what's meant to happen in your heart. I think that's what's happening in Habakkuk's heart. I wonder what's happening as a response in your heart right now. Let's just take a wee moment to pray, will we? And just allow our hearts to respond. And we're just opening our hearts to God, and we're just trying to keep our hearts and our minds soft and open and responsive to everything that he's been saying to us. Hope you felt the Holy Spirit and just pressing into your life as I spoke. I hope you sense the Father speaking words of hope and strength, or challenge, or invitation. Come, Holy Spirit, we give you permission to do whatever you want to do in us, with us, through us, We're all in. We're totally yours. We keep praying for those who are serving us and battling in the front lines of this virus, in hospitals, in the community, in care homes and residential homes that are really are battling at the moment. We're praying for those essential key workers, hundreds and thousands of different ways, many of them serving us, exhausted, weary, feeling the stress and the strain. For those of you at home trying to work from home, look after children at home, keep things going, looking after your children, some of them with additional needs, feeling busy and stressed. For some of you home alone, feeling isolated, just struggling with that isolation, struggling with not speaking to anyone. For every boy and girl who doesn't really understand what's going on, or who just feels sad in their hearts at not getting playing with your friends. For those in hospital right now in ICU wards, working as staff or in as patients, battling for their lives, praying for your families. For those of you who are grieving, for those of you who are grieving and find it difficult to grieve in the present circumstances, haven't been fully able to grieve, may you experience that gracious comfort of our Lord Jesus Christ and our loving Father. For those giving political leadership in Stormont and in Westminster, Father, give them wisdom, patience, perseverance. And this weekend we remember that 75 years ago on the 8th of May we saw the end of World War II. We remember those who served and sacrificed in that horrific battle in that generation. Oh God, we ask that you would turn our hearts from hurting and fighting and warring and teach us how to live in peace with one another so that we do not have to sacrifice our sons and daughters in war. And we pray over the abortion laws that are being imposed upon us and the distress that is causing us. We have such a love, such a heart for girls and for women who are facing crisis or unintended pregnancies, some of them in very difficult circumstances, some under extreme pressures. And we want to pray, Father, that you bring alongside such girls and women, just loving Christian people who may gently listen to their struggles and point them to think that maybe there is another option. And praying for the House of Lords as they're debating those abortion laws at the present and as they come to assembly. Oh Father, we want to value every life. Those lives that are pre-born, unborn, and those that are born. Women and men. Is there anyone particularly, for whatever reason, is on your heart? Just we'll lift them up with you as you lift them up. Families or friends, we're praying for you. in Jesus' name. Amen. Good. I want to finish with worship, so a worship song, feel free to listen, soak it in, or just worship out loud, just whatever is most helpful. Here's the song.
Shine upon you, be gracious to you.
finally, thanks so much for tuning in to us again. This transcript of this talk can be found on our Shore Street webpage, shorestreet.org. We love you. We're praying for you. We're happy that you send us in prayer requests, email them in. We're ringing around our senior members. We're producing material for children and young people. Our staff team are working hard. We're a community, we're a family of God. We're not here, the pews are bare in front of me. But as we pray the grace, I'm just going to imagine you sitting where you normally sit. Imagine yourself, and just imagine the family who are around you, and just bless them as we pray the grace together, the grace. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all, now and forevermore. Amen. Thanks so much, folks, for just being part of this. God bless you.